dat je luistert naar een nieuwe aflevering van Paul de Vries vanuit de podcaststudio in Ede met de missie de online automotive beter te maken. Dit doet Paul met de volgende partners met dezelfde missie: Marktplaats, Coldrip, Carmen Automotive BDC, Findio, Used Car Controller en tweedehands.be.
Thank all of you for having a leap of faith in being here today. You've given up a day to be with Paul and to potentially be with me. And a lot of times my business partner says, why are you doing this? You don't need to do this. You're flying all around the world and you're speaking to strangers. And what is it that you, what is the reason you do this for? And frankly, when I'm speaking to an audience, I really want to, I set the bar very low for myself. I want to reach one person. I want one person to say, hey, I got it. That makes sense. This is something I can take back to the dealership and use today. And I set the same low standard for myself when I attend a meeting. I want to find one idea that would help me sell one extra car a week or service one extra car a day. And if I do that, then I can sell 52 extra cars a year. And if I go to 10 meetings a year, I could potentially sell 500 extra cars today. So I'm hoping today that I'll say something that sparks, lights a spark within you and turns into a little fire. And then you can feed that fire back with your team and create a flame and do some special things. Our store is a little Honda store in Queens, New York. We're just outside of Manhattan. We're 2 miles outside of Manhattan. We don't have a lot of space. And when I went to several of the dealerships here in, I haven't been to any dealerships in Belgium. I've been to dealerships in Denmark recently in Amsterdam. And when I've gone to the dealerships, I realized that the biggest room in the dealership is the room for improvement. And in seeing these other dealers, I realized I still have a long way to go. And that's exciting because we sell about 11,000 cars a year out of our Honda store and about 4,000 cars a year out of our Acura store. And that's retail sales. Every one of them is belly button to belly button, one at a time, no fleet sales. And I wanted to share with you some of the concerns that I have about what's going on in our industry. I thought they were exclusive to the United States, but they're here too. And in fact, they're here before they got to the United States. So I really feel like I'm cheating because this is like reading next year's newspaper, seeing what's going on here. Is anyone here from the manufacturer? Oh, okay. Well, so I'm not trying to offend you, but we thought we had a partnership. And I'm realizing that partnership is, it's a profit ship. And you guys are gonna do what's in your intelligent self-interest at all times. And sometimes you think that means taking over the space that we share. And I'm gonna tell you that probably won't work. And hopefully the manufacturer that you're with realizes that, because you need us. We're really good at what we do. We're very efficient at distributing cars. And the information that I'm going to share with you, I'm not here to make you comfortable. And in fact, coming to Belgium and coming to the Netherlands has made me uncomfortable because I see the future. And the future is scary. I'm 61 years old. I have almost every dollar I've ever made invested in the automobile business. I don't diversify. I don't have stock. Well, I have stocks, but not many. Stocks and bonds. I have all of my money in the car business. And I believe in putting all of your eggs in one basket and carrying that basket very carefully. And now I'm concerned as I'm set forth to buy a dealership over the next 90 days and I'm paying money that I never thought I'd pay for a dealership. And I'm saying, what if a month after I get the dealership, Honda says, by the way, you're canceled. Like Stellantis did to the dealers here. You've got 2 years and you're canceled. And I would have said to you 6 months ago, that can't happen. There are laws to protect us. They can't do that. But I'm seeing it here. I'm seeing it in Denmark. I'm seeing it in the Netherlands. And it's the same manufacturer that we have in the United States. They're not different here. There's only different rules. So they're going to do whatever they can do. And so how do we navigate this difficult weather? And I think when we look at this, this is an incredible story. What a beautiful dealership, right? Lamborghini Dubai. And I went to a Mercedes-Benz dealership today, a Lumen store, and it was fantastic. I don't know how many square feet.
8,000.
Eight, how many?
8,000.
No, more than that. 8,000?
No,
no, you guys don't measure in feet. I do, because I pay for the real estate. It was massive. It was beautiful. And the manufacturer said, you want to represent us? You need to have a showroom that's 100,000 square feet, because our brand deserves that. And you know what they did? They built a temple to the brand. It was beautiful. I'm walking around and said, oh, I've got a video camera. And maybe you go on vacation. Maybe you go away for vacation. I go to car dealerships for vacation. And I was crazy in the head. It was like I was a kid at the carnival. And I'm videoing, saying, look at this, and look at this, and look at this. And I sent it back to my team. And it was 4 a.m. back in New York. And they're saying, boss, you can do that, please. And I said, no, I can't afford it, but this is beautiful. Look at this place. And then to hear that now the manufacturer, Mercedes, is saying to them, we're going to switch the business model. And you're going to become a distributor. And we're going to pay you a portion for the showroom space. But we're not going to pay for all this. This is crazy. Why'd you do this? But you told me to. But why did you do this? No, we're going to pay for 10,000 square feet. But you said I need 100,000 to represent the brand. No. We're only going to pay for this. And this is from what I can see. And I've met Mr. Luman, Eric Luman. And he's a gentleman, and from what I can tell, he does a fantastic job representing the brand. And he may be a great businessman, a good businessman, but he does a great job representing the brand. And when Mercedes is saying, we're going to change the game on him, I say, what if they do that to us? What if they do that to me? Because we were told we need to build facilities like this, and now we're saying, well, we're going to downsize the facility. And I think we can shrink the size of the facility. The question is, can you shrink the expense? I don't think so. What does the dealership of the future look like? Is it the Polestar Tesla model, which is they take care of everything 100%? And of course, right now, all the manufacturers are chasing this. Who's the richest person in the world? Elon Musk. A part of me is really proud. I always tell my wife, the richest man in the world is a car guy. And she says, well, you're not that. I said, I know that, but I'm trying. I'm in the right industry, okay? But he came from nowhere. He came from nowhere. And most of the time, disruptors come from outside of the industry, right? He didn't grow up a car guy. He didn't grow up an electric guy. He was in finance. And he went to General Motors and said, hey, I got this motor. And General Motors told him to kick rocks. Instead of kicking rocks, he decided, well, I'll do this myself. We're in the process of, and like I said, I'm buying this little Honda dealership. It's a little Honda dealership. We do okay in that store. And I'm going to try and turn it into a temple for the brand. And it's going to be small, like this. And what's great about Apple, and they do so many things right, it's exciting, it's entertaining, and it really encourages you to experience the brand. The ergonomics, right? The relationship between man and machine, to really interact with it. And you may think that we do this by having cars on the showroom floor. But I would, I don't know about your store, but I know many of the stores I go into, the car that's on the floor, and I sit behind the wheel. I want to experience the car. And the battery's dead. And so I can't even adjust the seat. And there's dust on the dashboard. And again, maybe not your store, but many stores, it's like that. So it's not really experiencing the store. And in my vision of the future, we're going to have a simulator inside the store where the customer can sit in there and take the car and put it through its paces. You know who won Formula One, right? Wasn't the Italians, it wasn't Ferrari, it wasn't Porsche, it wasn't Mercedes-Benz. It was Honda. Honda Motor. Max was driving a Honda car, and I want people to be able to experience that Honda engine inside the showroom. And if they want to drive our car 100 miles an hour through the city streets, the simulator will let them do that. And if I want to drive it up a mountain, the simulator will let them do that, and to really experience the car. And service. Is this what service looks like in the future? The Genius Bar, where customers drive into your service department, and you download, you take a scanner, and you scan the car, and you download the improvements, and they drive out. And they leave more satisfied with the brand than when they came in? Is that what it looks like? I don't know. But I do know one thing for sure. The time to reinvent is now.
Mm-hmm.
because you look so fine that I really want to make you mine. I said you look so fine that I really want to make you mine.
You are the one, do all the talking. You got me wrong, I caught you falling, I hear you calling.
So the challenge for us is the game has changed, right? The game has changed. Why reinvent? We have Peloton in the United States of America. Peloton is an exercise bike. I don't know if you've heard of it or if you have it here, but it's an exercise bike with a screen in front of you, and you can take an exercise class, a bicycle. I'm talking to the people here in Belgium and Denmark and Holland. No wonder you don't have Peloton. You actually ride bicycles. Okay, we're Americans, we don't ride bicycles, right? But we have a Peloton, and we can pretend that we ride bicycles, and you can ride the bicycle, and you can take a class, and you can pick the instructor. Oh, this is a handsome man. Oh, that's a beautiful woman. I want to take the class with that person. I want an intense class. I want a good workout, so you can pick an intense class. I want a 45-minute class. I want a 50-minute class. I want an hour class. You can pick the length of time, and you can also pick the music. I like hip-hop. I like rock and roll. I like pop. And you can pick it. You have shared control of the process. So the game has changed. And Carvana, they've got this beautiful pop-up machine over here, and they sold, I don't know, 400,000 cars in the U.S. last year. And I'm proud to say we made more money than Carvana. That's easy, because they lost a lot of money. But we made more money than them. We didn't have to sell 400,000 cars. But they're impacting what we do. They're impacting search. And you've got the equivalent here, I'm sure, in this country. And down below, we've got TikTok. A year ago, somebody wanted me to make a TikTok video. I said, I'm not 13. Leave me alone. I'm not going to make a TikTok video. And then a little while later, I looked at a friend. I was just sharing with a gentleman. My friend Barbara went on TikTok, and she's a host for NBC. You know Barbara Majeski. I think you've heard of Barbara. And Barbara made a TikTok video about how to carve a Halloween pumpkin. And she took a cookie cutter, and she hit it with a mallet in the eyes, and she carved out the pumpkin. She sprayed it, and she got over 10 million views on her TikTok for free. I sort of think 10 million views. I'm in the game of marketing.
Ik ben bang dat ik dat niet kan.
Right. I'm in the business. You see, it's a wow. 10 million. I'm in the business of getting eyeballs for the lowest possible price, and if I can get 10 million views. You know, so I went on TikTok and I started making some things, and I had a couple of things that did okay, nowhere near that success, but you know, it's one of those things I'm working on. But the game has changed. The players have changed. And you know, I pride myself, and I'm not bragging, but I'm in the field and on the ground every day in the dealership, and we come across other dealers. Our Honda store, and there's 1,100 Honda dealers in the country, and we finish one, two, or three every year for the past, I don't know, 15, 16, 17 years. Our certified used car department is number one in the nation for 15 years, and in fact, we double the next closest competitor in the country. And I say that not to impress you, but to say, you know, we've got some things figured out. And the really cool thing is we beat dealers that are billionaires, right? And we beat public corporations that have billions of dollars in assets. And I'm not afraid of that, I love that. But this is a different crew. This is a different crew that we're up against today. We're up against Elon Musk, and he's got lots of money. In fact, he's got all the money, and he's really smart, and he's ambitious as a school kid coming out of high school looking to make a name for himself. Warren Buffett, well, he's one of the richest guys on the planet also, and he's got a company called Berkshire Hathaway, and they decided they wanted to get into the car business in the United States. He took a check and wrote a check for 72 dealerships. He bought 72 at one time. And the thing that scares me about Mr. Buffett is he also owns the largest insurance company in the United States of America, Geico. So he's got access to incredible data. He's going to use that data with his dealerships to do some pretty good stuff. And then there's this guy. And we're going to talk a lot about him, Tim Cook. He's done some pretty amazing things. Can you imagine having to replace Steve Jobs? Can you imagine the shoes? First of all, he was an icon. How do you replace an icon? And he steps into that job, and he more than quadruples the bottom line of the company, reinventing the entire company, and kept the culture mostly the same. That's incredible. And then we've got
Jeff Bezos, we have not heard the last of him in America in the car business. You know, of course, he's got Amazon, and he took Amazon from a book retailer to a retailer of everything. And I think there's a lot of lessons we can learn from Jeff Bezos. I was just telling a couple of people during lunch that he first, let's take what Amazon did with books and let's take what the factories are doing with cars right now. Amazon got into the online book game and put all the book sales stores, not all, but most of them, out of business in the United States of America. And then what did they do?
Steeds meer collega's gebruiken Used Car Controller. Taxeren, calculeren, publiceren of auto's verhandelen met je persoonlijke handelsplatform? Met één abonnement geeft Used Car Controller je controle over alle kritische gebruikte autoprocessen. Zo maakt Used Car Controller je tot sterkste in je vak. Vindio is de merkonafhankelijke automotive partner. Vindio is er voor uw klanten en u. Zo kunt u zorgeloos ondernemen en uw rendement verbeteren. Uw online leads opvolgen binnen 30 seconden? Dat kan met Coldrip. Vraag direct een demo aan.
They opened up bookstores in the United States of America. Amazon has bookstores. But instead of having a 20,000 square foot bookstore, they have a 5,000 or a 3,000 foot bookstore, a smaller bookstore, and they only stock most the highest demand books, the books that are in highest demand. How do they know? They've got the data. Now imagine it's the OEM, and imagine if we can do this with the OEM, we can reduce the size of the footprint, only stock the cars that are the fastest turning. Certainly if you want something else, we'll order it for you and we'll get it for you, but only stock that using the right data. So we don't have to keep those slow-moving cars. They don't have to build the slow-moving cars. We can only stock, because I think there's a real opportunity there. Hey, for the women in the business, Mary Barra, she's the CEO of General Motors. It's a heck of a job, and she's doing a heck of a job at a heck of a job. And you may not like General Motors, I don't care for them, but it's great to see woman representation at a meaningful position in our industry, and I think that's great. And this guy, he's impacted our business. Dr. Fauci, in the United States of America, and his handling of COVID, I think changed the way we do business. I didn't know that guy could close my dealership down. I thought, this is America, free enterprise, separation of business and government. We can be in business. And Fauci said, no, you got to close them all down. And what do? My expenses at our dealership are about $3.3 million a month. And most of that expense was still there when we were closed down. And I was sitting in my basement with COVID, shaking. Oh my God, how many months? We didn't lose $2 million a month. We lost, I guess, about $800,000 the first month. And so I'm doing one of those charts. How many months can I do this before I'm broke? And, you know, it's not a long answer. I'm telling my wife, I'm sick with COVID, I'm dying. And, you know, after you get over feeling sorry for yourself, you get busy figuring it out, and thankfully we figured it out. And the most important change of all, of course, is the customers. Uber Eats, I've got a 14-year-old daughter, Poppy, and she'll order a cup of coffee from Starbucks. The coffee's $5, the Uber Eats driver's 12. She thinks that's good math. I don't think it's good math. And of course it's good math for her, because she is using my credit card, so it makes all the sense in the world for her to have a mocha latte frappe, whatever it is, frappuccino, delivered to the door. This is a government check. This represents the bribe that the U.S. government gave to people to stay at home. We're going to give you more money to stay at home than to go to work. And they didn't think that through, because when you do that, you change the value proposition to people. Wait a second, if I can get $1,500 a week sitting at home, why would I ever go back to work for $1,200 a week working 40 hours? I don't want to do that. Now what? Because you and I are left with those employees, and I don't know if it's the same here as it is that backed by us, but now the employees, they say, no good, not fair, I want more money, I want less work. Zoom, working from home, I've had some of those experiences with my kids climbing all over me, my wife yelling at me in the background. It's really embarrassing when you're on the phone with the team, and you're the big guy, and your wife's like, clean the room up, hold up that, and honey, I'm on the call, I don't care, you let, and it's embarrassing. So, quick question, where do customers start their journey, their shopping journey?
Online.
Online, yeah, and in the States, it's with Google. And search, of course, is really interesting. Paul's math, and I think that math is great. We've had 60,000 unique leads coming in. We know from direct research with Google, and I'm on Google's dealer advisory board, and so I look at the numbers, and there's a direct correlation between search and purchasing. In fact, people that search for things buy things, and that correlation for cars is nearly 1-to-1. It's 1 to 0.89. So for every 100 people that search for a car, 89 buy a car. And so if we could explain that, Paul, I think, you know, we've tried beating salespeople over the head, and that doesn't work. If we can share with them information that you're going to speak to 10 people today, and 9 of them are going to buy a car, the question is, are they going to buy it from us, are they going to buy it from you, or are they going to buy it from somebody else? And when they start looking at those buyers as real buyers, as shoppers, and not shoppers, but buyers, I think you change the perception there. And I had the privilege of speaking with the folks at Google, and I said to Google, you know, I've got a proposition I want to work out with you. I said to Google, what's the number one search engine? And, you know, we're old. They were all a bunch of pimple-faced kids with Apple computers open. I see all the Apples there. I said, what's the number one search engine? Oh, go, Google! What's the number two search engine?
YouTube,
correct, YouTube. And I changed the question just a little bit. What's the number one search engine for retail? It's Amazon. And why is that? And so now all of a sudden these kids are leaning in. And I said, Google, through search, brings the customer to the product. The customer to the product. And Amazon brings the product to the customer. And I thought, that's a really big difference, right? Google's not transactional, so that they only get you halfway there, but these guys are transactional. And I thought, how could we take the power of Google and the effectiveness of Amazon and combine them? And for everything that we do. So we spoke about this already. Most of the breakthroughs, they come from outside the industry. So I'm looking from outside of the industry when I'm sitting there with Google. And, you know, the interesting thing is when I was with those guys, they looked at me like a dinosaur. I walked in a suit and tie and a suitcase. And there were a bunch of kids there with backpacks and hoodies. And they looked at, look at the dinosaur. Oh, he's still alive. And I'm doing like a T-Rex. And they're like, oh, he's still here. It won't be for long. Don't worry about it. But the really great thing was I learned a ton from them, and they learned a ton from me because they didn't quite understand our business. I had a presentation that I was doing for Google, the global team, and I gave them the deck, and it changed the deck. And thank God I looked at the deck beforehand. And I talked about the new and pre-owned department. And they changed new and pre-owned to new and old. They said, you know, you don't have pre-owned cars, you have old, right? If you have new, I said, you can't call the cars old cars. And they really didn't understand our business at the level they needed to understand the business. So what we're looking outside of the industry for solutions, I looked at Amazon. What are Amazon's hours? 24 hours a day. 24 hours a day I can buy something. So if you're truly serious about changing the game in your dealership, how accessible to your customers are you when they want you to be accessible? Are you available 24 hours a day? And we looked at that, and if I went on Amazon at 7 o'clock at night and said, sorry, we're closed, come back in the morning, it would be ridiculous if I logged on to Facebook to see my grandma and they said, sorry, check with us later, we're closed right now, we're closed for lunch, we're closed for a break. It's ridiculous. What do our customers think of us? Then we looked at Netflix, right? Netflix put Blockbuster out of business. Why? Because they brought the movies to us, and they didn't pick a device. They didn't say, okay, it's got to be on television. It's got to be on a laptop. It's anywhere. You can consume the internet. You can consume your movie. And I see my staff half the time sitting there looking, and I ask, what are you doing? Oh, following up with a customer. Well, that looks like a movie. Oh. You know, they're there. Uber Eats, of course, the same deal. You can have anything brought to you that you want locally. And this over here, this is part of the, and I hope to bring this all together, the learning from this and this and this. And this is my dry cleaner. And this suit, chances are, was dropped off in my garage in a bag on a Tuesday. And the dry cleaner picked it up and brought back the laundry from the week before. And then on Friday, he'll bring back the suits and pick up the laundry right from my garage. And that's not unique in New York. And it's a great service in our community. He comes to the garage, picks it up. Because how many times have you lost a ticket and you can't find the ticket? You go in there, and he picks it up and he goes back and forth. The story here, and what I thought was really something to get a learning from outside of our industry, is I've been using that dry cleaner for 15 years. I've never been to that dry cleaner, not once in my life. It's not relevant. And I thought, is it relevant to the customer to come to me to do business with me? And it's relevant to me, of course, because we built these big, beautiful facilities. And I want people to come to the facility, but is it relevant to the customer? And I thought, what if it's like my dry cleaner? It's probably not relevant. The game changing, the players changing. Well, one of the players changed the game. My assistant, Rachel, had to order some headphones. And I said to Rachel, order them from Apple and get them in 2 hours. She said, what do you mean 2 hours? There's an option. You can have the headphones delivered in 2 hours. And she ordered the headphones, and 2 hours later, knock, knock, knock at the door, and there are the headphones. I said, can you believe that? They screwed everything up! They did it! They screwed everything up! They're changing the customer expectation. And that customer will not go, it's the toothpaste is out of the tube. You can't put it back in. You can say, well, I don't want to deliver my cars in 2 hours. I don't want to deliver service to the customer. You've got no choice. Because these guys are changing the ball. Used to be next day delivery. Oh my God, that's great. Overnight, Federal Express, Amazon, it's amazing. And Apple's saying, no. 2 hours for $100 headphones. Wow. I'm saying, well, now what? How do we compete with these guys? And there's a bunch of different lessons in here. One of the lessons is the Uber drivers during COVID. What happened? Nobody wanted to get in an Uber. They were afraid of getting COVID in an Uber. That left all these drivers with nothing to do. That left all this additional capacity. And smart business people like Uber and Uber Eats and restaurants used that existing platform to deliver their products. Why can't we do the same thing? We can.
Dank u wel voor het luisteren naar de DCDW-podcast van Paul de Vries met de missie om de online automotive beter te maken. Vond u deze podcast interessant? Abonneer dan meteen via Spotify, SoundCloud of iTunes en deel deze podcast via LinkedIn met uw netwerk. De DCDW-podcast van Paul de Vries wordt mede mogelijk gemaakt door de volgende partners. Marktplaats, Coldrip, Carmen Automotive BDC, Findio, Used Car Controller en tweedehands.be.